pass it around so that everybody has a chance to do that. You are clean. We all set? Let us also reflect upon the gesture of humility here and the lesson of commitment made by Messiah Yeshua when on that night he laid aside his garments and girded himself with a towel. And at the bottom of 8, if you would read with me, please. Then he poured some water into a basin and began to wash the feet of the Talmidim and wiped them off with a towel wrapped around him. And he said to them, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me Rabbi and Lord, and you are right because I am. Now if I, the Lord and Rabbi, have washed your feet, you also should wash each other's feet." And that's a quote from John 13:5. Okay, wash each other's feet. How many here have ever participated in a foot washing ceremony? It is a humbling experience. The next item on the table is something called karpas. And you will look down on your Seder plate or separately in bowls on the table, you will see sprigs of parsley. Like so. Okay, and you will also see a small bowl of salt water. And the word says, as you lift up the parsley in your hands, Passover is a holiday that comes in the springtime when earth is becoming green with life. This vegetable is called karpas, represents life, created and sustained by Almighty God. Now also if we have the bowl of salt water. It's all here. Should be at least one on the table. Life in Egypt for the children of Israel was a life of pain. Suffering and tears represented by this salt water. Let us take a sprig of the parsley and dip it into the salt water, remembering that life is sometimes immersed in tears. So everybody dip a piece of parsley in there and just hold it in front of you. This evening is like Simon Says. Nobody does anything until this guy says to do it. Okay? So everybody take a sprig. As you hold that in front of you, the prayer is Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Borei Pri Hadama. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the earth. Now let us play. Let us together eat the karpas. I have a visitor. And welcome, please, Aaron, if you would. Let's give Aaron a hand. He's right on cue. Aaron is going to bless us because what is on now on page 10 is the four questions. And these are very important. Why are we here? We're here year after year because, as it says, and you saw Moses say in the video, that we are here to pass this along from generation to generation. It is the whole of us understanding why we do this, year after year after year. This is the Passover feast. This is not in any way, shape, or form a Jewish holiday, as is Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and all the other major feasts. They are, if you are that confused, feasts of the Lord, and we all belong to the Lord. So here we have the privilege of now Aaron, who is my representing our youngest child here, and he has blessed us because he is now going to ask four very important questions.
Which means, yes, you can give them a hand. How different this night is from all other nights. On all other nights, we eat bread or matzah. On this night, why do we eat only matzah? On all other nights, we eat all kinds of vegetables. On this night, why do we eat only bitter herbs? On all other nights, we do not dip our vegetables even once. On this night, why do we dip them twice? On all other nights, we eat our meals sitting or reclining. On this night, why do we eat only reclining?
And on 12 are the magic answers. So if you are there, let's read on. You are to observe this as a law in your descendants forever. God doesn't mess around. He wants us to look after these things and observe these things forever and ever. And Malachi 4:4 says, do not forget the laws of Moses. It is both a duty and a privilege to answer the four questions of Passover and to recite the mighty works of our faithful God. The matzah, the unleavened bread, there is some at your table. We say that on all other nights we eat bread of leaven, but our Passover we eat only matzah, unleavened bread. As the children of Israel fled from Egypt, they did not have time for their dough to rise. Instead, the hot desert sun baked it flat. But even more than that, the scriptures teach us that it is leaven that symbolizes sin. Everybody together, don't you know the saying, it takes a little chametz leaven to leaven the whole batch of dough. Get rid of old chametz so that you can be a new batch of dough, because in reality, you are unleavened. For our Pesach, Passover, Lamb, the Messiah, has been sacrificed. So during the season of Passover, let us break our old habits of sin and selfishness and begin a fresh, new, holy life. We have a plate here of matzah on the table. Okay, and I have more than three, but traditionally there are three. This is the bread of affliction, the poor bread which our fathers ate in the land of Egypt. Let all who are hungry come and eat. Let all who are in need share in the hope of Passover. 3 matzah are wrapped together for Passover. 3. I wonder why that is. The rabbis call these 3 a unity. Some consider it a unity of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Others explain it as a unity of worship, the priests, the Levites, and the people of Israel. We who know Mashiach, Messiah, Jesus, can see that in this unique triunity of God, Father, Son, and Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh, 3 in 1. In the matzah, we can see a picture of Messiah. If you hold it up, please, everybody can see. Take one piece and hold it up so that everybody at the table can see it. Okay, you will see there are stripes. Miraculous how that happens. There are stripes. But he was wounded because of our crimes, our transgressions, crushed because of our sins, our iniquities. The disciplining that makes us whole fell on him, and by his bruises, his stripes, we are healed. But again, hold that matzah up and hold it to the light. What do you see? Little holes. Little holes. I will pour out, everybody say with me, please. I will pour out on the house of David and on those living in Yerushalayim, Jerusalem, a spirit of grace and prayer. And they will look to me whom they pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only son. Removing and breaking, you can put that matzah down. Don't eat it. Just as the middle matzah here on this plate. The middle piece of the bread of affliction is broken, which I did already. Aha. Messiah too was afflicted and broken. One half is now called the Afikomen, and I will do it again just so you know. Okay? It is called the Afikomen. And I learned this in a Baptist church. But I grew up in the synagogue and never understood that the word Afikomen was a Greek word, not a Hebrew word. And it means he has come. Whew. Man, that blew me away completely. So we break the middle matzah. The bread of affliction is broken. And Messiah too is afflicted and broken. One half is now called the Afikomen, or the coming one. It is wrapped in a white cloth, just as Messiah's body was wrapped for burial. And it was wrapped, and I already wrapped it. It is hidden in this room. And later on, the children in the room, that's people below the age of 12. No, Jamie, you can't participate. The Afikomen was hidden. And just as I have hidden the Afikomen, so Messiah was placed in a tomb, hidden for a time. But just as the Afikomen will return to complete our Passover Seder, so the sinless Messiah rose from the dead to ascend into heaven. So it has been broken. And what I'd like you to do is take half of that matzah. The other half. We have a half that is the Afikomen, and that piece is hidden. But take one piece at the table, just one. Break it in half, and take that half, and break off a little piece for yourself and pass it around the table. So hold up that piece of matzah in your hand, please. Remember, Simon didn't say it. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, hamotzi lechem min ha'aretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. You may eat that piece of matzah. Now, if you'll notice that in your Seder plate and also in another bowl, on the table are bitter herbs, otherwise known as horseradish. Okay, traditionally, there would be a root of the horseradish in the plate. And we say, and I'm at the top of 15 if you're following, all of the nights we eat all kinds of vegetables. But on the Passover, we eat only maror, bitter herbs, as sweet as our lives are today, let us still remember how bitter life was for the children of Israel in the land of Egypt. So we're going to lift up, just so I will do that, we'll lift up the horseradish here. And we say, Baruch Ata Adonai, Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Asher Kedishanu B'Davro, V'Tzivanu Al Chachilat Maror. So what I'd like you to do now is take another little piece of matzah and put a little horseradish, if you're daring, put more on that piece of matzah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has set us apart by his word and commanded us, be careful, to eat the bitter herbs. Oh, my goodness, Jane. You may eat. If that's Yeshua, I'm not here. Okay, we're on 16 now. We're moving along. On all of the nights, we do not dip our vegetables even once, but tonight we dip them twice, and we have already dipped the parsley into the salt water. But now you will see another mixture in front of you, a brown mixture. It is charoset. The children of Israel toiled to make treasure cities for Pharaoh, working in brick and clay. And we remember this task. And a mixture called charoset is made of chopped apples and honey and nuts and wine. Let us once again scoop some bitter herbs onto a small piece of matzah. Just take a little bit, scoop it onto a piece of matzah. But before we eat, let us dip the herbs into the sweet charoset. So take your matzah, little piece, and put a little charoset on that. Okay, and we accomplish that and lift that up in front of you. And we dip the bitter herbs into the charoset to remind ourselves that even the most bitter of circumstances can be sweetened. So what I'd like you to do before you eat is also to take a little bit of the horseradish, the bitter herbs, maror, and put it on top of the apple, on top of the charoset. Just a little bit. Okay, and everybody's lifting that up in front of you. And you may eat that. You guys are doing well. As they were reclining and eating, Yeshua said, "Yes, I tell you that one of you is going to betray me." And they became upset and began to ask him, one after the other, "You don't mean me, do you?" "It is one of the 12," he said to them. "Somebody dipping matzah in the dish with me." Tonight we recline. On all other nights, as Aaron read so aptly in Hebrew, on all other nights we eat either sitting or reclining, but tonight we eat reclining. The first Passover was celebrated by people who were enslaved, everybody together. Once we were slaves, but now we are free. I'm in the middle of 17. The children of Israel were instructed to eat the Passover in haste. Their loins girded, their staffs in their hand, their sandals upon their feet, awaiting departure from the bondage of Egypt. And today we may recline and freely enjoy the Passover Seder. Why? Why are they supposed to eat that way, with their armor, their sandals, their belt, everything together? It simply represents the faith we have in Messiah. Messiah Yeshua and Adonai, that we are going to be obedient to his commands. It is all about faith. So Messiah said, come unto me, I'm on the bottom of page 17, all of you who are struggling, who are burdened, and I will give you rest. Amen. Amen. The story of Passover. Magid, I have remembered my covenant. There were many covenants made in the scriptures that you read. One was made with Adam. One was made with Abraham. One was made with Noah. And one was made with Moses. The story of Passover is a story of miracles, a story of redemption, a story of mighty power of God to overcome evil. Larry, would you please read one there?
The Lord has promised the land of Israel to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You hear were their children in Egypt. The Pharaoh, who had come to power, feared them. They're foreigners in the midst of prospering and have grown numerous, he thought. Suppose they join with our enemies and turn against us. Pharaoh decided to exert control, greater control over the people, imposing harsh and bitter slavery upon the Israelites. Still, God blessed his people in strength and in number.
Pharaoh grew more frightened and ordered every baby boy among the Israelites to be drowned in the Nile River. One Israelite couple hid their little boy for 3 months. Finally, entrusting his future to God, they set him in a basket and placed him upon the river. His sister Miriam watched as he floated downstream. Coming upon the basket, Pharaoh's daughter took pity on the child and chose to raise him as her own son. She called him Moses, meaning drawn from the water.
Moses grew and became aware of the travail of his people. One day in a rage, he lost control of himself and killed an Egyptian who was beating a Hebrew slave. Fleeing the place in the eye of Pharaoh, Moses became a shepherd in the land of Midian, far from the cries of his suffering brothers. And I'm on the top of 19. The Lord, however, saw the affliction of his children of Israel, and he heard their groaning. He would raise up a deliverer in the land to lead them out of bondage. It was then that he appeared to Moses in the midst of a bush that burned with fire. Yet it was not consumed. Moses drew close and listened to God, who commissioned him to go to Pharaoh. Fearful and reluctant, still Moses agreed to bring God's message to the king of Egypt. Let my people go.
When Moses was in Egypt's land, let my people oppressed so hard they could not stand. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land.
Moses left the wilderness to return to Pharaoh's palace. It says in Exodus 6:6, it says, I will free you from the forced labor of the Egyptians. And as Moses went to the palace, the very place where he had been raised, he returned with a message which the Lord had given him. But God himself warns Moses of the resistance that he would encounter. Over and over again, if you read the scripture, it says that the Lord would harden Pharaoh's heart. Everybody together, please, page 20. I know that the king of Egypt will not let you leave unless he is forced to do so, but I will reach out my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders that I will do there. After that, he will let you go. God sent plagues one by one, yet with each plague, Pharaoh hardened his heart. The Egyptians became afflicted with discomfort and disease, bane and blight. Still, Pharaoh would not relent. With the 10th and most awful plague, God pierced through the hardness of Pharaoh's impenetrable heart. Everybody, for that night I will pass through the land of Egypt and kill all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both men and animals. I will execute judgment against all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord, Adonai. Let us fill our cups a second time. Again, they should have plenty of juice there at the table. A full cup is a symbol of joy. And indeed, on this occasion, we are filled with joy at God's mighty deliverance. But let us also remember the great cost at which redemption was purchased. Lives were sacrificed to bring about the release of God's people from slavery in Egypt. But a far greater price purchased our redemption from slavery to sin, the death of Mashiach Yeshua. As we recount each plague, let us dip a little finger. You're going to take your little finger and dip it into the cup and let it drop on your plate. Okay? So again, when we say each one together, you're going to dip it in your little finger and you're going to let the blood drop on your plate. So everybody together. Blood. Frogs. Lice. Beasts. Cattle disease. Boils. Hail. Locust. Darkness. Death of the firstborn. Okay, we're not drinking the second cup yet. Understand, if you've read this section of scripture, Exodus 12, every time I see the recounting of Moses coming before Pharaoh and pleading with him and saying, this is what I'm going to do, and horrible things happen to the people of Egypt, and oddly enough, they never happened to the people who were the Israelites who were living right adjacent to those people in the land of Goshen. Everything that happened happened strictly in Egypt, and the Israelites were totally exempt from all of that. But as Moses went on, plague after plague after plague, in the margin in my Bible I wrote, Oy! Or if I'm a dyslexic rabbi, I'd say, Yo! Anyway, I just can't believe